And we welcome Sergio Alivernini again with his lecture on Landscape Philology, Natural and Anthropic Environment in the Ur III Texts. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Okay. Can you see the screen?
We can see your screen. Thank you.
Perfect. So, thank you very much. I would like to start by thanking Armando Bramanti and Alexander Edmonds for inviting me. I want to thank also the International Association for Archaeological Research in Western and Central Asia to host me. Since basically I'm a polite guest and this is the Association for Archaeological Research, I would like to start by telling that despite I'm a philologist, I'm really convinced of the value of the archaeology to reconstruct the history. At the end of the day, neither philology nor archaeology produce a reconstruction of the past, but all of them can produce kind of an impressionist painting, where basically every dot is irregular and flawed in some way, but a picture at the end come out of it. This is also true for the history of the Third Dynasty of Ur, which is a period during which five kings who belong to the same lineage exercised power over southern and northern Mesopotamia and had the control either directly or through a system of taxation and alliances over a large part of neighboring geographical areas and even distant political entities. Just to cite two scholars that in recent years have successfully combined epigraphical approach with archaeological one, I would like to cite Stephanie Rost and Christina Tsoparopoulou. Anyway, if we talk about the Third Dynasty of Ur, I have to admit that the kind of documentation we can use to reconstruct the history of the period is unbalanced in favor of the epigraphical documentation. This is basically due to the fact that Ur III faces are poorly excavated. And also when they were excavated, often the dig was done more than one century ago, where archaeological methods were not refined enough. For example, the excavation in 1894 by De Sarzec at Girsu, Pello. Moreover, for sure, 40 years of wars in Iraq did not help very much the archaeologists. There were the Iran-Iraq war, then the first Gulf War, then the second Gulf War, and the war against ISIS. In the last years, the excavation in the southern Iraq restarted again with French, American, English, Russian, and Italian missions. We can just briefly cite Russian-Iraqi integrated expedition in Tel Wahilia, the Iraqi-Italian excavation in Abu Beira and Tel Zurgul, the German-American excavation in Ur, the French-Iraqi mission at Larsa, and the British one at El Kaiber. So I hope that in the next future, we will have a better knowledge from an archaeological point of view of the Ur III period. But anyhow, as I said before, there is no doubt that at least for the moment, texts represent our best sources for the reconstruction of the Ur III history. Also, the reason because we call this period Third Dynasty of Ur is due, as you know, to a text, to the Sumerian King List, where this period represents the third time that the power, after the destruction of the former kingdom, was transferred to Ur. Just to have an idea of the incredible amount of epigraphical documentation we have, imagine that there are more or less 100,000 texts known from this short era, approximately one century. And probably hundreds of thousands are still in the deposit of the museums, or they have to be excavated here. Despite the documentation is very rich, it has several problems. The immense majority of them were not excavated legitimately, so that essential information conveyed by their archaeological context has been lost forever. On the other hand, by their action, looters and dealers have provoked the dispersion of the corpus in hundreds of small and large collections, which complicates the identification of the provenance of the tablet, of the tablets, and the reconstruction of their archival relationship. Taken globally, Urtri texts can be found today in at least 758 collections in 40 different countries. Considered individually, the dispersion of some of the archive is also striking. The provincial archive of Girsu, which was in part officially excavated, is split up in at least 214 different collections. The archive of Umma and Puzrish Dagan, which on the contrary were never excavated by the archaeologists, except for a few recent campaigns, are dispersed in at least 483 and 411 different collections, respectively. Another problem is that the majority of the documentation come from just three archaeological sites, Umma, Girsu, and Puzrish Dagan. We have circa 30,000 texts from Umma, 27,000 texts from Girsu, and circa 16,000 texts from Puzrish Dagan. Then we have 3,600 texts from Nippur, 1,500 from Garshana, 1,100 texts from Irisandri. From other sites that often represented also very important provinces and cities of the empire, we have just a handful of tablets. For example, we have 150 tablets from Eshnunna, Tel Asmar, just four from Isin, and just six from Kish. Moreover, I want to highlight that we have just 4,200 circa texts from Ur, which was the capital of the empire. So just to do an example, it's like the historians in 2000 years try to reconstruct the history of Czech Republic, where I'm living now, having the majority of the documentation coming from Brno and Pilsen, and having little documentation from Prague itself. So summing up, we have a rich documentation, but despite this richness, we have only a partial vision. The last problem, I would say, comes directly from the nature itself of the documentation. Almost all the documentation is of administrative and economic nature. This is, of course, true for all the periods of history, and I would say this is true also nowadays. But in the case of Urtri, we have little or no documentation of different typology. And practically all of what we know about the literature, the science, and so on, comes from the following old Babylonian period. An example is given by the so-called royal letter of Urtri, studied by Michalowski. They represent epistolary exchanges between the king of the third dynasty of Ur and their officials, and could be very important for the reconstruction of the political history of the period. But these documents, as highlighted by several scholars, must be considered with caution, precisely because they were written many years after the fall of the Urtri Empire. So I highlighted several problems, but despite all of them, the documentation from Urtri allows us not only to reconstruct the administrative and the economic history of the empire, but also the political history. A distinctive feature of the Urtri administrative practice was the regular dating of tablets through a system that combined local and state calendars. In the preceding periods, months were named according to local calendars, a usage that continued with the third dynasty of Ur. Although now the calendar in use at Ur was also followed in other archives managed by or bound to the royal administration, such as those of Puzrish Dagan, Drehem. But the real difference with former periods was the acceptance of a common dating system with year names throughout the Urtri state. Year were thus called after the same remarkable event in all royal, provincial, local, and private administrations. This procedure had already been applied during the Sargonic period, but its use was then much more limited. The dissemination of such a dating system over a vast area during the Urtri period is important for various reasons. The names of the years recalled important events related to the territorial policy of the three kings, the political life, the state internal organization, religious events, or building works. For example, erection of the Shara temple, the wall against the Amorites, and so on. This designation obviously belongs to the sphere of the royal propaganda, but provide interesting information that can be contrasted with other sources. For example, Menhir's name can inform us about military activities of the Urtri state. We have, for example, year Karkar was destroyed or year Anshan was destroyed. For the political life, we have, for example, the coronation of kings. So year Shulgi's king or year Amarsuan is king. But also political wedding. So for example, here the governor of Anshan took the king's daughter into marriage. We have information also about the internal organization of the state, as for example, this one. Here the men of Ur were conscripted as lancers. This year name can probably be interpreted as the creation of a standing army. As for the religious events, we have, for example, appointing priests. Here, En Nirzana, the En priestess of Nanna, was chosen by Xtispish. And finally, as for the building works, we have, for example, here, Shusuen, the king of Ur, built the Amurru wall called Murik Tidmin, holding back the Tidanum. As I said before, this designation obviously belongs to the sphere of the royal propaganda, but we can find sometimes a crossing reference of the events in the year names also into the administrative documentation, or also other kind of documentation. An example is given by the year name, the ninth year of reign of Shusin. Here, Shusuen, the king of Ur, built the temple of Shara in Umma. As shown by Stenkeller, this year name found a confirmation from administrative text. The erection of Shara temples at Umma is commemorated not only in the formula of Shusuen's ninth regnal year, but also in Shusuen's dedicatory inscriptions. Given its mention in a year formula, we can be confident that this undertaking was a project of national importance. This specific case was studied by Stenkeller, I think in 2015, 2016. Anyway, who highlighted, thanks to the comparison with administrative text, several details regarding this construction. First, while the temple was completed in the ninth year of Shusuen, or possibly in the preceding year, the project had begun much earlier, probably already in the last year of Amarsuen's reign, when some preparatory works may have been carried out. This is suggested by, for example, this text dated to the last year of reign of Amarsin, where the text recorded 10 liters of Ea bitumen, probably liquid bitumen, valued at 12 grains of silver, which was passed over the reed of the sanctuary of Lal Ip of Sharas. Shara's temple. Be that as it may, the construction began already for sure in Shusuen's second year of reign, where we found this text that records 750 kilos of broken bitumen to calc the foundation platform of Shara's temple. We have also a ship and floor were presented as part of the Siskur offerings for the retaining wall, which is Kisa. So one ship for the Siskur offering for the retaining wall of Shara Temple. So these examples are basically, I mean, I did this example to show that the administrative documentation in Urtri period could be used not only for the reconstruction of the functioning of the state from an administrative and economic perspective, but that we can also use it to reconstruct aspects of Urtri history which are more practical, I would say. One of the aspects that can be, and it was, investigated by working on the text is the problem of the environment. How was the environment in southern Mesopotamia during the Ur-3 period? More specifically, which were the different components of the environment, both artificial, for example, canals, agricultural fields, walls, but also natural, the rivers, the sea, plants. The environment is something that from one side has to be exploited, but this exploitation can take different forms. Resources can be simply extracted from the environment, leaving it as it is, or the environment can be transformed, adapted, tamed through artificial ways. Yes, of course, there is also another way, leaving the environment in peace and not exploiting it at all, or giving it a break sometimes and exploiting it less. But this is a different story. Nowadays, as it was in Mesopotamia 4,000 years ago, human being needs to use and to exploit the environment. Before starting, I would just like to clarify one point. In the modern terminology, sometimes the word environment is used overlapping its meaning to the word landscape. Actually, there are differences between the two terms, but the differences are not always clear and sometimes dependent also from the author. One difference could be linked to the point of view. Environment-focused studies are concerned with the world in relation to which humans are external observers, while landscape-oriented approaches place people at their center. Despite the widespread use of the word landscape, most studies actually focus on the environment because they concentrate on quantifying its different aspects. In contrast, landscape is the outcome of people's perception and engagement with the world around them. And as a result, its characteristics are far less quantifiable. Now, it's not the case and the place to address the difference between landscape and environment here. And I would like to point out that what I'm going to show you in this paper is basically how was the aspect of the area where inhabitants of southern Mesopotamia lived at the end of the third millennium. Then if you want to call it environment or landscape, it's up to you. The shape that the area where they lived, where the ancient Sumerian lived, is important because it has an impact on the daily life of the population and consequently on bigger scale on the society. Let's start by saying that this kind of studies is something that must be done with the help of other disciplines, archaeology, of course, but we need also in the modern times, bioarchaeological and paleo environmental analysis, for example. But I don't have any of this expertise. So what I'm going to show you today is simply what the Ur-3 texts tell us about the environment. How we can imagine the general landscape or environment if we read the Ur-3 text. Let's start with the most common and probably most famous feature of Mesopotamia in general, and Ur-3 in particular, agricultural fields. Many years ago, Giovanni Pettinato, and then Mario Liverani described and studied the text that more than the other give us an overview of the agricultural landscape during the third dynasty of Ur. The administrative practice of field measurements attested through Mesopotamian history dates back at least as far back as the Uruk 4th period and can be traced during the third dynasty of Ur, especially in the city of Girsu, in two different types of documents. We have text providing measurement of the surface of agricultural fields and of their yields. These include the round tablets, a group of documents drawn up shortly before the harvest to record the production of every field. Then we have plans of fields drawn on tablets with captions and measurements. There are 40 published Ur-3 field plans from Girsu, Nippur, Umma, and Ur. These documents show on the obverse the plan of the field. Since the fields are often irregular, their shape is divided into regular figures, rectangles, triangles, or trapezoids, in order to make the calculation of the surface easier. An example is given by this text, kept in the Louvre, which was studied by Freiberg and also Camille Lecomte and also by myself. This drawing that you can see on the left side of your screen were not very accurate in the sense that the images drawn is not to scale and give us just a sketch of what was the actual, the real shape of the field. If we use the measurement written on the tablet, we obtain actually this picture. As shown, so you can see this is a bit different from the drawing in the tablet actually. As shown by Liverani, these elongated, long fields were the prevalent shape of fields in southern Lower Mesopotamia, as shown by the round tablet. These, the round tablets are texts which were made out shortly before the harvest in order to prepare an assessment of the yield. The surface area of each field was measured for this purpose, so long side by short side, plus addition and minus subtractions. And this was then subdivided into portions, differentiated in accordance with the level of the yield expected. Since basically these kinds of text measure also the sides of the field, we could have a clear idea about their dimension. In general, these are approximately rectangles with lengths exceeding widths by a factor of 10 or so. Hence, they were real strips. The system used by the Neo-Sumerian scribes and already by their predecessor is to indicate the four sides of the field using the cardinal points. So we have Kur for east, Martu for west, Ufai for south, and Mer or Mir for north. Even before the Neo-Sumerian period, the elongated shape of the fields generate the habits of indicating only two cardinal points when the opposite side of the rectangle are equal. In our round tablet, for example, not only are the two directions, north and east, the only ones systematically recorded, but in addition, these two directions have been fossilized so that they refer respectively to the long side, Mer, and to the short side, Kur, without regard to their actual orientation. So if we look at this end copy of a round tablets, and we read the first two lines, which record the measurement of the sides of the field, we can read 218 Minda, Mer, He, 38 Minda, Tri Kush, Kur, He, which are equal to 1,680 meters for the long side and 229 meters for the short side, because one Mindan is 6 meters. So you can see that the shape of the field is exactly the one of a strip, with the long sides much longer than the short side. Of course, these fields needed water. And when we talk about water in Mesopotamia, we are talking of the water of the two rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates. But we are also talking about the infrastructure which were used to bring water from the rivers to cultivate fields which were not adjacent to the rivers itself. Basically canals, but not only. Canals were the most visible part, and I would say the most famous part, so to say, of a series of infrastructures, water-related infrastructure, which included, of course, canals, but also, for example, banks, tanks and reservoirs for water control, barrage for waterways, dams, and mud walls. Several Urtri texts describe the building and repair of canals or their components. These works would have required the use of different materials in accordance with the typology of the facilities to be built. But the most important was definitely earth, the land. What the UR3 text show us, especially the text from Umma, is almost a constant moving of earth, Sumerian Sakar, for building or repairing this water-related infrastructure. So we have Sakar Ziga to pile up earth, Sakar Ziga to remove earth, Sakar Shuti to collect earth, Sakar Shu Bal A to transport earth, and then we must also add Ba'al La to dig and Shu Shulu Ak to clean the bed of a watercourse. So till now we have seen that the UR3 text show us a landscape composed by a long strip of agricultural fields. There were also several canals which were managed through a series of infrastructure composed mainly by land, by soil. The canals were of course different from one another. The biggest difference is, of course, the sites. We have primary canal and secondary canals. The former defined E7 or ID2, which basically means river. The latter defined PA4 or PA5. An example of primary canals would probably be the canal going to Ur. That was a canal probably going from Girsu to the capital city. Or also the canal of Girsu that probably connected Girsu with Umma. These canals, both primary and secondary ones, were very important not only for the irrigation, but also, of course, for transportation. At the end of the millennium, the transportation of people and goods via watercourses are attested in thousands of documents and evidenced in all UR3 provinces. If one looks at the documentation coming from the city of Girsu, as already observed by Bertrand Lafont, boats from the province of Girsu-Lagash reach centers within both the province and outside. Although Girsu ship and boat text are rich enough in terms of quantity, they often fail to contain the basic information needed for the reconstruction of routes, such as travel days or the waterways used. Despite these difficulties, as is well known, the documentation reveals that connection by watercourse involving the province of Girsu-Lagash was very substantial. Not only this can be shown by reference to the quantity of text, but also in particular by a number of texts that explicitly inform us that goods were loaded onto boats in many areas of the province. Although the documentation rarely refers to an arbor or arbors, car, actually in Sumerian, several zones of Girsu-Lagash province had harbors where ships were loaded and or unloaded. Such harbors were not only recorded in the main center, but also in granaries, fields, villages, temples, and mills. In the Girsu-Lagash province, several documents record the fact that boats were loaded in various places in the province with goods being of different typologies. The basic idea is that we can reconstruct the network of harbors by collecting all the texts which mention boats carrying goods. This text, apart from the quantity of the goods loaded, may also record the location where loading operation took place. From this fact, we can assume that these sites had harbors used for loading and unloading goods. Just to be more precise, I think that in English there are several words that define a place where boats can be loaded or unloaded: dock, harbor, port, quay, wharf. But we don't know how these structures appeared physically in UR3 times. Therefore, basically, it's impossible to use the correct word to define them. So basically, in order to simplify things, I'm going to use the word arbor, which is, according to the Webster dictionary, a part of a body of water protected and deep enough to furnish anchorage, and seems to be the more general definition. However, texts describing the movement of goods on boats do not often contain information about the place of departure or arrival, limiting themselves to recording the amount of goods and the names of the responsible officials. Some texts, on the other hand, contain only the starting place and the names of the official who gave and received the goods, while others only record the place of arrival. Moreover, some texts record just a list of boats with its loading capacity and the place where these boats are located. Anyhow, all these kinds of texts allow us to provide a list with the name of the place where harbors are located. It is worth stressing that if one looks at the text more closely, it is not that simple to decide whether a given geographical name is identical with the place where the good mentioned in the text were in fact loaded. Consider, for example, this text. In this case, we can't assume that the barley was loaded in the field of Nabasa, because we have no information where the barley was actually loaded. This is an administrative document which record the origin of the barley, field of Nabasa, and its way of transport, but it is not meant to record the itinerary of the barley. On the other hand, there are texts that clearly states where the goods are actually loaded. There are two expressions that indicate that something is loaded onto a boat. Ma'a sika, loaded onto a boat, or ma'a garra, placed onto a boat. An example of the first expression, ma'a sika, is given, for example, by this text. So we have a considerable amount of barley from the granary Egibile, loaded onto a boat, and then the name of the official. So basically, this text clearly records that over 90 tons of barley were loaded from Egibil field. It is so clear that this field is a place to load goods onto a boat. An example of the expression ma'a garra is given by this text. In this case, 33 workers for 21 days placed wood onto a ship and towed it from the Egibile field to Girsu. Because the texts are not always clear regarding the place where the goods are actually loaded, we must use caution and distinguish among texts which records places where boats are loaded and others where we can't through it. More specifically, we can be sure that geographical name or names mentioned in a text at a place we can define harbor in the following case. For example, texts which record that boats have been loaded in or from a specific place. So for example, this one, tons of barley loaded onto a boat in the field Abala. Text which records boats belonging to a specific place. So one boat of 80 gur of capacity, one boat of 60 gur of capacity in Kinunir. Text which record a number of workers for a number of days loading and or towing the boat from a place to another. For example, 30 workers for 30 days towed a boat from the field X up to Girsu. So keeping this in mind, this list shows all places in the province of Girsu Lagash that had an harbor, divided into settlement types, so in habitat center, agricultural field, granaries, and so on, and recorded also in alphabetic order. As can be seen from this scheme, harbors were located in all three districts of the province, in both major and minor inhabited centers, so Girsu, Guaba, Nigin, and so on. Most of the documentation is extremely accurate, precisely recording the name of the field, Asha, where the goods were loaded. Other harbors can be identified in administrative units such as granaries, villages, and also temples. Therefore, we are in a position to assume that each, or probably almost all the administrative units, had a place for loading or unloading boats. We have if you count, more or less 35 of such arbors recorded in the administrative documentation just of Gisula Gasprons, with the majority of them placed, as you can see, in agricultural field, which is a quite high number. So basically, if one would like to have a picture of the actual landscape as it was described in the Urtui text, it is going to be probably something like that, more or less. So you have agricultural fields separated by canals with a boat going from one place to another using the canals itself. But till now, I show how could be the shape of the environment modified, so to say, by human beings. Building of water-related facilities, as well as agricultural fields, shows how the environment bent to the needs of mankind. Since the mid-20th century, the development of Mesopotamian civilization has been seen as being intrinsically linked to the building of water-related infrastructure, so dams, canals, as we saw, to tame the environment. Anyway, marshes represent, even today, one of the most peculiar aspects of the environment in southern Mesopotamia. And recent studies by Purnell and Wilkinson, and also by Oates in the 60s, have underlined the importance of marshes in the economic landscape of southern Mesopotamia in the fourth and, to lesser extent, in the third millennium. This peculiar ecosystem offered a broad spectrum of economic resources, in particular reeds, salt grasses, and several kinds of fish and birds. Such a variety of the resources is well attested since the very beginning of the cuneiform tradition at the end of the fourth millennium, as well as in the third millennium sources, such as entries on lexical lists, all as storable goods in economic account. Ambar and sug are the Sumerian terms denoting the particular type of wetland which can be identified as a marsh or swamp. If one looks at the written documentation, we can recognize two different attitudes toward the marsh. From one side, an abundance of fish in marshes acts as a sign of land prosperity and corresponds to a well-defined literary topos. Indeed, it occurs in what can be considered a standardized list of fertility elements, a literary motif attested in various compositions, most often in connection with the god Nanna, as observed by Michalowski. Needless to say, most of the compositions attesting to this list date back to the second millennium, except for Nanna's journey to Nippur, which according to Wilke originated during the time of Ur-Nanma, so the first ruler of the third dynasty of Ur, therefore at the end of third millennium. As shown in the following chart, each fertility element of the list is associated with a specific landscape, among them different kinds of fish in marshes. So, in the canals, carp flowed, in the fields, speckled barley, and then we have ambarra, kuda, sukurku, in the marshes, kuda fish and perch, maybe, perch. However, in royal inscription, this picture of wild resources in a generous landscape can turn into one of a place to be tamed. A clear celebration of the drainage of a marsh area can be found in one inscription of Ur-Nanma, the founder of the third dynasty of Ur. Here, the ruler claims to have brought out from the water the surface of a swamp planted with palm seedlings and measuring more than 200 square kilometers by creating a new artificial stream. He underlines that despite the presence of planted trees, specifically date palms, it was an actual swamp, suggesting a negative picture of that landscape. He claims then that he made it as a lasting treasure for the city of Ur, the capital of his kingdom. So for Nanna, blah, 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 Ur-Nanma, a swamp planted with palm seedlings. In spite of that, it was indeed a swamp. From the water, he brought out for him, as a lasting treasure, he made it. In any case, we are far away from the negative picture of marshes occurring in later literature, where they can be a symbol of devastation in opposition to civilized cities, as for example in the Lament for Ur, a composition dating back to the early Old Babylonian period. In that composition, in fact, the goddess Ningal, wife of Nanna, is lamenting the loss of her properties in her city due to the marshes, suggesting a clear opposition between civilized city and untamed nature. So basically, Ningal said, my properties like in the city have been consumed, have been eaten by the marsh. In contrast, in Ur-Nanma's inscription, the picture of the marsh is not completely negative one. It was planted with date palms, which in the context of gardens are a symbol of richness and prosperity. In this context, it seems to have been considered rather a wild resource, tamed by the ruler in order to create a lasting trace for his capital, something that can be controlled and systematically exploited for the wealth and richness of the state. This inscription does not describe an idyllic landscape, delightful for human beings, but often instead a rational picture of a wealthy state. Nevertheless, as we will see, thanks to the recent studies of Angela Greco from Sapienza, University of Rome, and Noemi Borrelli from the University of Bologna, both the idyllic wild and the rational tame aspects of the marshes coexist in the economic documentation. There are not many documents, but they show how this environment, that is the marshes, had its space, so to say, in the economy of the empire of Ur III. Administrative texts, indeed, provide evidence for marshes as a source of wild commodities, as well as for, presumably, drained fields being next or within marsh areas. We have, for example, Asha Ambar Nizala, field in the marsh of Nizala, or also field in the small marsh of Nanna. Administrative texts show that these fields were cultivated with the usual crops. So barley, emmer, different kind of onions, pulses, and spices. Fields surely represent the tame aspect of the marshes, but how did they exploit what was untamed? As already stressed, marshes provide a broad range of economic resources, such as reeds, shrubs, trees, and a wide variety of fishes and waterfowl. Unlike the literary composition, which offers a standardized and limited picture of resources available in marshes, administrative texts can provide more hints on the variety of exploitable goods. As it is common when we talk about Ur III, most of the information in this regard comes from Umbangirsu, which represent the most informative economic and administrative corpora of the world third millennium. Two texts from Ur-III Umma, one published in Nisaba, one in the Kusas series, concern the employment of workers in actual marsh areas. In both texts, indeed, there is a mention of men settled by the marshes. Nisaba, the text published in Nisaba, records the account of arrears of state-dependent workers of the duty rotation in the Apisal district. Among the listed workers, there is a group composed of four both builders and men settled by the marsh. The second text, the one published in the series in Kusas, concern a work and inspection of spare fishermen, sesame farmers, both builders of the inspector of fishery, and men settled by the marsh. In another Ur III text from Umma, which is published in the Uti series, the workers are clearly employed for exploitation purposes in marsh areas. This text indeed records the employment of workers for towing a boat for 3 days toward the marshes, loading the boat with reeds, and then going back to Umma in 5 days to unload the boat. Although the provincial economy was primarily interested in maximizing the income derived by the arable land, the very same geographic location of Gitzulagash enabled the local population to entertain a multifaceted economy connected with the presence of different water sources. The province of Gitzulagash was indeed located in the southernmost fringe of the country, and its territory was delimited by the frontier of the Umma province to the northwest, by the Tigris to the east, and by the presence of tidal wetlands and the ancient coastline to the south. The geographic administration of the province, strongly influenced by the presence of diverse water environments and its intensive agricultural exploitation, make Gitzulagash a preferred example for the topic of water management. As highlighted by Borrelli, the size of the area affected by the presumed presence of brackish water was quite considerable. The Sumerian word for brackish water is Amun-4. It occurred in the so-called provincial cadastre carried out by King Shulgi's order in the 36th year of his reign. If we look at the text, the size of the area affected by the presumed presence of brackish water was quite considerable. In this cadastre, more or less 950 hectares of land with brackish water were located in the area of Nigid. Moreover, also the water taken away from fields was indeed brackish water. The relevance of this province in the economy of the Urtui state is hinted at by the fact that it alone delivered multiple times a year the rotational payment called Bala, which is a sort of taxes, a kind of tax, which was due by each province to the central government. Beside grain and grain byproducts, this provincial taxation also includes reed bundles. We have also other texts, like for example this one, a long balanced account of fishermen works, suggesting once again the relevance of the water environments for the economic life of the province. So the environment where the inhabitants of Sumer lived were composed by long fields, canals, and boats going around. But along this tamed environment, there were also a wilder one, the marshes, and the epigraphical documentation, the administrative documentation, shows also that this kind of environment, of landscape, was important. Sumerians were capable of using it by finding a way to incorporate untamed water and its products in their economy. Thank you very much.